And so here's a screenshot showing what the evaluating multiple results looks like, where I'm looking through the different, all the various results that came back. So if I did Beaver Creek, Louisiana, I get back 16 possible locations, and then I can scroll through these results to see them. And I can click on any one of these red markers. I don't know if you can see the red markers off to the left side of your screen, but I can click on any one of these and they'll instantly light green when I do that on the screen and make that marker active. And I can, there's also an X, a little X next to each one of these markers, and I can just X them out if I don't want to see them anymore. I'm like, that one's not active. I can just kill them off my results set so I don't have to see them anymore. But ultimately, my input coordinates are going to be the whatever is associated with the green dot. All right, so that's the most basic way. You load up the manual georeferencing client and type in some data and georeference it. And that's one way to work with it. It's probably the best way to get started, to get a feel for how geolocate works. But ultimately, we all have lots of data and we need to work with it in a more efficient system. So there's a batch georeferencing system where I can take a spreadsheet of data and I just upload it to our servers and then we can work with it within this system. So what I do is I can then batch georeference a page of records and then go through and just start working on these records one at a time, making edits and saving it down into the spreadsheets. And you know, it offers all the same features as the other, as the manual entry, data entry client. I can sit here and double click on any one of these cells and re-edit the data, re-georeference it and play around with it. What's nice about the system is, I mean, you know, working on the web, sometimes you're doing something and your browser crashes, bad things happen. What we do anytime someone uploads a spreadsheet to the system, we create a unique ID. I don't know if I can see it on the screen. I have to click on this file management link to actually see it. But it creates an ID that you can then save. And so, and as long as you have that ID, you can recall that file. So you can, you know, anytime you upload a file, you're given this little unique code. You save that code somewhere. And then you can come back and work on that file at any time. So you're not stuck working on this all at one time. So you could upload a couple hundred records and just work with that whatever time you're doing. So the next big focus of geolocate is actually doing something to facilitate collaborative georeferencing. And by collaborative georeferencing, I mean the process of sharing data, having a number of different people involved in the georeferencing process. So this is usually what you want to do if you're your georeferencers are distributed, they're not all located at one place, or you have data coming from a lot of different data sources. There are some advantages to working big batches of data, and I'll talk a little bit about those in a second, that we can take advantage of to really maximize the efficiency of the georeferencing process. And so I'll talk a little bit about how sharing data helps. And so what we want to do is be able to try to maximize georeferencing by eliminating the amount of duplicated effort, looking at similarities among locality descriptions, as well as just duplicated locality records. So if I look at this result set, this is probably hard for everyone to read here. There are a number of localities here for a place on the Homochitta River, and this is just the first, I went to Fishnet, and all I did was type in Homochitta River, and I got back a whole bunch of results, and this is just the first page of results, and as you can see, you know, there's one that says Homochitta River, 5 miles east of Union Church, at Highway 550. There's another one that says 4.7 miles east of Union Church, Highway 550. And so there's a number of different ways it's represented within this list of locality descriptions. And in some cases, some of these are just identical duplicates. So if I had a way to eliminate the stuff that does not reference the exact same place, and then georeference those localities all at one time, I can go through and correct all of those collecting events at once and increase my efficiency significantly. And so, to evaluate how well does that actually work, what we did is we took data from the Tulane Fish Collection again, and we went through and we evaluated how the algorithms that we're using to identify similarities and identities among records, and to see what we could end up reducing our workload to. So for 2,100 randomly selected records from the Tulane Fish Collection, we were actually able to create a number of records, unique records that needed to be georeferenced, came down to about 782 records using the method that's used within geolocate. So we reduced 63% of the workload that we would have had to perform just by being able to make some relations. Now, I will say, the Tulane Fish Collection does have a high degree of repetition among its collecting localities. So these numbers probably overestimate the gain that you might get within your collection. But I wouldn't say it would be that drastic of a difference. then the other thing is the ability to distribute workloads and manage how that's done. So within the collaborative georeferencing system, the idea would be to take an area, let's say in this particular example, this was for a student project where we had a number of volunteer students working on fishes within Arkansas, and we divided up the state into a number of regions, and then we assigned those different regions to each student, and then later we'll come back and look at the results that each student did. And so within the collaborative georeferencing system, the way it is, there's this concept of communities. And a community is that self-contained object that represents a number of different data sources that represent it could be various institutions, it could be data sources from various regions, whatever, but that's the data that's being shared. Within a community, all the data is independent from any work that's going on in other communities. And then there are the users, and users could join any community they want. Oftentimes, there's usually just a couple of communities that are run by a couple of people, and they have a bunch of users that work within those communities. And so the way the collaborative georeferencing works, there is a data management portal where someone can log into, get a user account, upload data, create communities, set the different options for georeferencing, manage the users, all that kind of stuff. And then using one of the clients, you can still use the desktop client, although we'll probably be deprecating that feature soon just because the number of features that are available now in our web-based client actually exceed all the functionalities that we have available in our desktop client. And so you log in through a website and you go ahead and start verifying the results of automated georeferencing. So when the data get uploaded to the portal to begin with, they're already georeferenced. They get georeferenced beforehand, and then just using one of these clients, your end users then just go through the process of retrieving records and verifying the results of georeferencing. And so this is just a screenshot of the entry page for the data management portal. And within the portal, there's options to create communities. You can have public, restricted, or private communities. You can set different options for if you want to do the water body matching or look for bridge crossings. You can add data sources. This screenshot's a little old. Originally, this work was funded to go on the side of a project we were doing with Fishnet to upgrade it to upgrade some of the networking technology so we're supporting bigger providers, but as that has come out of fashion, we no longer support uploading data through bigger connections anymore, and right now we're only supporting the CSV file upload. And once you get your data uploaded, you can generate these URL links that you can send to people. And what that allows them to do, because oftentimes, you know, you might have a number of students that will be working on the project, and the data management portal, even though anyone can go to this portal and sign up to use it, it can be a little complicated and intimidating at first because there's so much other stuff that goes on there. So the idea is you can create one of these easy sign-up links and you send a link to someone. They click on the link, all they have to do is fill out their user information, and they're instantly signed up to use the portal and instantly added to that community that you sent them the link to. So it makes it easy if you have a number of students that you want to sign up without having to get into all the technical details of the portal and some of the other options. So within the georeferencing portal, there's options in there so that you can subdivide data, as I was talking to, and this is just a screenshot of how you can't really see it because it's cut off a little bit, but I can identify individual users, and then I can go through and I can assign data to a user, say, hey, your job is going to be to verify all the data within this data source or within this geographic region. And then also within the portal, there's various little widgets for monitoring progress. You can see how much work is being done at the user level, how much work is being done at the community level, and so on. And then at any time, you can log into the data portal and then download the results from that portal. We're actually working on trying to find ways to make this a little more of a seamless process, particularly with certain providers. So like if you're within a specified database, it would be really nice if there's an option within here or somewhere within specify where you can click a few buttons and automatically adjust the results back into specify. One thing I should notice, you'll see here, like in this particular example, there are two corrections for a record. The idea is every time someone verifies a result within the collaborative georeferencing portal, no result ever gets replaced. It's just another opinion. And so it's possible to have multiple georeferences for a single locality. And it's up to you, the data manager, to decide which one you'll accept. And I'll talk a little bit about how we're doing that with the FishNet project. And we're basically just taking whatever's the last one, the most recent we made corrections, the one we'll be using. But if that one turns out it's not a really good place, we could actually look historically and see what other changes were made to that record. And so here's a screenshot of the georeferencing portal, so I can just outline some of the features real quick. Within the portal, like I said, you click the next record button and it automatically downloads the next record to your browser. It highlights it in yellow, and now it's up to you to go through and adjust that record. So I can, the record displayed on the map, I can move it around, I can create a polygon, I can edit my uncertainty. And then down here, you'll see it found two similar records. And then I can expand the little tree view, and it'll show me the two similar records that it found. And then further down beneath it, you don't see here, if I unexpand this, you'd see that there could also be some identical records that it may have also found. And so I could check off this little checkbox, and it would automatically select all the identical records. I could individually select the ones that are, in fact, the same place. And then you can also see, so what I'm uploading to the portal is I'm not uploading locality data. I'm actually uploading specimen data. And within our portal, we go through, within the data management system, we actually normalize the data out. We take this flat data, this flat spreadsheet of specimen records, and we separate out the collecting events from the specimen records, and we present that to you. So you can click on any one of the locality records and see the specimens that are associated with that record. And then another option is you can create hyperlinks associated with every specimen. So I could click on this, and for this particular project, these are actually links that would then take us back to the FishNet 2 project and let us see that record within FishNet 2. But if your data are available online, you could click on this, and let's say you had field notes or other images available. You know, I could click on this and let's say bring up a record of that field note or something. Another couple of things. Let's say I georeference it. Oftentimes, geolocate will return a result, and let's say it's not a very good result, or you might have a paper gazetteer in your hand, and you're like, I see it right here on my map. I need to get that information into here, or you georeference it using Google Earth or something. Well, there's this option for you to hand type in the results and send that to the collaborative georeferencing system. So I can add a latitude, a longitude, and the uncertainty, and it'll create that for me and adjust that record that I can then send back off to the system. And I mean, that's very useful because oftentimes, you're doing georeferencing, but you end up going to some other website to find the coordinates. So you're not stuck on just using what's within geolocate. You can get your coordinates from any other system. There's also the option to add comments to any record, and a lot of our georeferencers do that. You know, they'll comment on errors within the data, or if they have to make a judgment call as to where they're putting the point, oftentimes they'll comment the reasoning for making those judgment calls. And then if I can't find the record at all and I just want to skip it, I can hit skip selected, and that's going to prompt the user for a reason. Every person who skips a record must provide a comment as to why the record is skipped. And then another feature within it is oftentimes you're georeferencing and you want to go back and look at some of the previous work you've done within the collaborative system. So we've recently implemented this history feature, which keeps a log of every single record you've ever corrected within your browser. So I can then go back and grab all the records I've done before. And where this is really helpful is I have a record within the workbench, and I'm like, oh wait, I think I've corrected that in the past. I can go to my history, I can find that record within the history, and then I can use the data for that record and move that into the workbench. I can also use the history to go back and say, well, when I originally did this record, I didn't know that area very well. I want to go back and recorrect this one. So I could come here and just take that entire record and move it to the workbench. It could also go through and find all the similar and identical records that match that and move that over to the workbench with it. So I could then recorrect every record that met the criteria that were georeferenced identical to this record. So a little bit about interoperability. One of the things we're trying to do is to make it as easy as possible to use whatever system you want for georeferencing, data management, whatever. And so we have a number of services available for doing georeferencing. As Deb was showing how you can do it within Google Find. You can also plug into R if you wanted to. You can use it within Specify, Symbiota, there's even ways you can use it within Excel and ArcGIS. And I'm going to highlight just a couple of these options as to how it might work in some of these systems. So for Specify, a lot of you guys have probably seen this, where you can go through and back have to process the data set within the specification.